First, let me thank you for that kind introduction, and to also say what an honor it is to be here this evening, particularly to share this evening with two distinguished, passionate, and fun colleagues, Drs. Kreek and McEwen. So today, I'll be speaking about the adolescent brain. And quite frankly, the adolescent brain has become something of a media darling. And I think in part that's because we now have the opportunities where we can almost voyeuristically look under the hood of the behaving adolescent brain. But it's also because of some of the alarming statistics that we hear about adolescent behavior, and often these behaviors can lead to fatal outcomes. So let's just begin by really describing what is adolescence. This is something that is typical in development, occurs across multiple species, and is really that transition from dependence on a parent to relative independence. Now, the onset is somewhere around puberty, but the offset, if they're truly independent from a parent, can actually go on indefinitely these days in our society. So we often characterize this period by describing it as one of experimentation, where the adolescent is testing the boundaries of society, what they can and cannot get away with. And what I'd like to present today is to suggest to you that part of this experimentation is due to heightened sensitivity to cues out in their environment, incentives, threat, social cues, so they can establish where they are in a social order of things. And then it's actually these processes that we think lead to the novelty seeking and risk taking. Now, the significance of trying to understand this in the context of the human brain is really underscored by statistics that, as someone with a now 19-year-old son, I still get a visceral response. And that is that basically teens in the US have a 200% increase in mortality rates. And this is not from disease. These are from preventable causes. It's the adolescent putting themselves in harm's way. The majority of these are accidental deaths, but we also see suicide and mortality. This is also when we see a heightened emergence of psychiatric disorders, some of the most common, anxiety, stress-related disorders. And what often goes along with experimentation also leads to abuse, and that is this pattern or emergence or inflection in the use of substances that go right on up until the 20s and then subsequently decline, as you see here. So these statistics, as well as the behaviors that you and I potentially engaged in, we all adaptively came through adolescence or we wouldn't be here tonight, which is a good thing. But it really begs the question of what's going on in the adolescent brain during this time that might explain some of these behaviors. Now, discoveries in our lab at the Sackler Institute and with others, we've begun to recognize that what's going on in the brain is really what I refer to as an imbalance that happens between systems that are primitive and deep, that have been associated with desire and rage and fight and flight, and those that are more involved in rational decision-making and self-regulation. If you'll see in this movie, these red areas are the center, emotional centers of the brain, being marinated in gonadal hormones, neurotrophins, and neurochemicals that are changing. And this green area it's still green, it's still maturing, and its projections to these systems are not fully mature to quiet that system down when need be. So what I'd like to spend the remainder of this presentation highlighting is empirical research from our laboratory that really focuses on this idea of this enhanced response to cues in the environment that pull an adolescent to do things that even when they tell you, I knew better, they can't seem to help but engage in that behavior, and they say they can't stop themselves, as if that prefrontal system, that control system of the brain, if those of you who know Star Trek, I like to call it the Vulcan part of the brain that's rational, and it's trying to keep sometimes Captain Kirk, who's emotional, at bay. When they're in balance, it's the perfect scientific journey, but when it's the imbalance, trouble breaks out. So probably just a basic way that we can examine how adolescents respond to different things in their environment is to look at even just simple monetary gain. Is there a difference across development? Do they look different from adults? And more importantly, from children too. If it's specific to adolescents, you need to know what precedes it as well as what follows it. Well, in our laboratory, Adriana Galvan did a study where she simply looked at how the brain responded when adolescents were given large amounts of money as opposed to smaller amounts. They're just performing a simple task. They get it right, they get a lot of money. And what we see is an exaggerated response in an area referred to as the nucleus accumbens in adolescents relative to children or adults. It's this area here, a deep structure that's been associated with learning about pleasure and rewards, and it's been implicated time and time again in addiction research. Now, what's important about seeing this elevated activity in the brain is it's also true that this area is associated and correlated with the likelihood of an individual engaging in risky behaviors. So what you'll see over here is just a correlation, regardless of age, when the degree to which you activate this region to monetary gain is associated with how risky you are. So during adolescence, there's both this developmental heightened sensitivity, but you may already come in with a predisposition to be a little risky, like leaving a party with a stranger, acknowledging that in an anonymous self-report. It's not just money that drives behavior. We're very interested, and part of the title today is about self-control. And so we're interested in how cues in the environment can really sort of take over control, so that they don't feel like they're self-regulating. And you recognize that your teenagers really are trying to pick up a lot of information from facial expressions, just as a speaker does to make sure people are listening sometimes. We are in tune with one another by being able to read that emotion. So we wanted to see how would just positive social cues, how would they help or distract or hurt self-control by having them be rare but pop up on a screen in our laboratory, and we would tell them, don't react and don't attend to them. What we see is adolescents cannot help themselves. So they are making many more errors when a rare cue, smiling like this, comes up relative to either children or adults. If it were a neutral cue, something that wasn't arousing, you wouldn't see much of a difference here. And then the same area that's activated to monetary gains is also the area where we look in the brain to see what are the regions that parallel this pattern in the behavior. It's the same one, it's the accumbens region. This is just showing you looking down on top of the brain. And we see that it's elevated during this time to these positive cues. But what about a real interaction? Let's put a peer right next to the individual and see how they influence behavior. And one of the individuals who have really taken the lead on that we're collaborating with now is Larry Steinberg. And what his lab has done is to develop this clever little video game where you're just asking the individual to whether or not they're gonna go through a yellow light at an intersection, and I know you've all thought about that at times. When do you go and when do you not go? Yellow light does not mean go as fast as you can to go through. So what we're doing is we're measuring in adults and adolescents how many times they make risky choices. And of course, if it's too risky, then what you're seeing here is the broken windshield and they crash. And basically, adolescents look identical to adults, which is in blue here, in risky decisions and also in number of crashes, except when there is a peer present. They're just sitting next to them. Doesn't influence the adults. This type of work has really led to some policy changes with regard to licensing of adolescents and driving of cars. But then if you look in the brain and you say, what area in the brain is activated
when they're making these risky choices, I'm sorry to beat a dead horse, but it's the same area, now you're just looking at the front face, same area, the accumbens, and it's activated specifically when they're making a risky choice, specifically for the adolescents relative to these adults. So this is quite compelling. And I think that what we want to understand then too is, because social cues are so important to them, what do negative social cues do to their self-control? Over a lifetime, we learn to associate expressions like this as something somewhere is going wrong, and there's this uncertainty. So you have this little emotional center in the brain, another region I'll be referring to as the amygdala, that's trying to understand the emotional significance and prepare the body to flee or fight or freeze. And so what we've done is to try to see how do threat cues actually impact self-control or impulsivity. Can teenagers ignore them? They're negative. They're not this positive sort of bringing them in. Well, it's surprising, but adolescents, particularly male adolescents, when engaged in a task and a rare threat cue comes up on the screen, they've been told, don't press. They can't stop themselves. They're reactive. They press to it. And this is very different, again, from children who actually withdraw from such stimuli and adults. And again, I mentioned this region of the amygdala, and we've shown before in our lab that this area is showing that same response, this heightened tendency to be activated when they're seeing these potential threat cues. But how you graduate from adolescence is how well you can regulate this emotional response, right? Emotional reactivity, we assume, is somewhat typical, but you have to learn to regulate that if you're going to engage in pro-social behavior. So let me just illustrate for you the difference between most adults and most adolescents in the lab when they're presented with these potential cues of threat. So on the top is the adult. You're going to see these emotional centers, the amygdala. At first, it's activated. It's trying to understand the emotional significance of this cue to them in this setting. Nothing's going on. It should return to baseline, and you'll see that in blue. Now, this is in sharp contrast to what we see in many of our adolescents. And that is, basically, initially, they're activating this region each time they see a potential cue of threat, and they activate this region, and they activate this region, and they activate this region. It's also exactly this pattern where they don't normalize the system that's associated with everyday ratings of anxiety and symptoms of anxiety disorder. And it's an imbalance between these prefrontal and amygdala systems that have actually been shown to be compromised in anxiety and stress-related disorders. But what some of you may be thinking is, well, you've already said that adolescents are really sensitive to social cues, so these faces are just so salient to adolescents. Is it really a fair comparison? Really good point. Is it that, or is it that they can't learn when they no longer have to be vigilant to particular cues? Well, one way we can address that is to use these classic paradigms that have been used in animal research, where you take something neutral, you pair it with something aversive, and then you look at how the animal behaves to that cue once it's been paired with something bad. And so we turn to work with our collaboration with Francis Lee, also at the Sackler Institute, in measuring fear in the adolescent mouse. And here are the two ways we can do this, just to simplify it for you. We can first give that mouse a little foot shock, and then after just a couple pairings with that, what you'll see is if you pair it with a tone, the tone itself will elicit a freezing response. To then see if they can extinguish that fear, you just play the tone in a new environment, and you play it over and over and see whether or not they can recognize now this is safe, and that's called extinction. You can also instead of just looking at cues in the environment, it's very important in terms of adolescence. They're explorers. They're having to actually adapt to many new spaces, locations, and environments. And so we also wanted to test to see how well they can learn when those are safe or threatening. But let's just begin with the cued fear in the mouse. So again, we're just pairing it a few times. And what we're interested in after we pair the tone with a little foot shock is to see how quickly they learn that that tone is no longer dangerous. Now, we're very interested in the human, so we also did parallel studies in the human. And instead of looking at freezing behavior, we used sweat or galvanic skin response, and we didn't do little foot shocks. Instead, we used an aversive sound that's somewhere between your alarm clock and static noise. And we would pair that with a yellow or a blue square. And it was randomized across subjects which one of those colors we did. And then for the extinction trials, we simply just presented those squares and we compared the difference to make sure that they were learning between the one that had been paired versus this. And then during extinction, we look at both of them to see if they can extinguish that fear. First, let me just show you the paradigms again for the both species, the human and the mouse. And that's shown here. And then also, just to let you see that the fear learning itself, these are just the adult data. Children, adolescents, and adults, they get it. They learn very quickly that one particular colored square is associated with something they don't like. And that's shown here with the galvanic skin response to it. But what about extinguishing that fear? Remember in the movie, is it that it's just salient to them? Or are they just not learning that now they're things are safe? They can bring it down a notch. And what we see is really striking, and it wasn't expected. So a number of these experiments have been repeated and replicated and in parallel that the same finding has been in other groups, shown in other groups. But what you see is that children and adults extinguish. So the higher that bar is, the more of a decrease that you see in their skin conductance response, the sweat. And the same thing's true in the mouse. But where we're seeing a difference is that the adolescents don't seem to be extinguishing the fear association as quickly or as easily. This has huge implications for clinical treatments for stress and anxiety disorders. One of the most common is cognitive behavioral therapy that is exposure-based. Exposure treatment is based on basic principles of extinction learning. And so this is actually preclinical data to suggest an adolescent may not be as responsive as a child or adult for those forms of treatment. And we're already beginning to think about alternative ways that we can modify different forms of therapy. Now, I mentioned before that the adolescent is also exploring new environments. So let's try to understand what's going on in the context of putting a mouse back into a chamber where the day before they were shocked in that chamber and see how they respond, and does it differ as a function of age of the animal? And this one is another one that was just unbelievable. You know, it's often you predict one thing and when you get the exact opposite finding, it just opens up the doors in new ways that you never anticipate for your science. We basically see adolescent mice looking fearless. You put them back in a cage where they were shocked the day before and they don't freeze. So they're not showing any freezing behavior. But the pre-adolescent mice, which is equivalent to the childhood ages, and the adult mice, they're freezing. So does this mean that they're not able to learn that a context is potentially threatening? Is this why they might be going into situations that are dangerous and not remembering? Well, here's the one that really blew our mind. It turns out if you've ever worked with human infants or data or tried to measure behavior in the mouse, it's this tedious job of looking through videotapes. And so the student, Siobhan Patwell, decided that she'd had enough coding videotapes of freezing behavior in mice. And so she wanted to try this new automated software. So to test that software, she went into the mouse facility and pulled out a cage of adult mice, and she proceeded to put one of the mice at a time in this cage just to test it out, and then she was going to test the software. The first mouse she put in that box jumped right out. The second mouse, she thought, something's wrong, kind of weird. Puts his next mouse. It's cowering over in a corner. She's like, something's wrong. She cleans the chamber, everything. She tries again. They won't. They're just freaking out in this box. And then she says, okay, I got to go back, and I have to look at the notes on the cage. Who are these adolescent mice? Who are they? They're those adolescent mice that express no fear whatsoever as an adolescent. But it wasn't that they couldn't learn. They'd learned. It's delay recall of that fear memory. And that's shown right here. She then went on to do multiple experiments where she started whole new groups so she can control all the experiences that they had between this time point and this time point. Same finding. So I've now provided you with three or four examples of discoveries and ways in which we're looking at the adolescent brain. I want to start to help us unpack this in terms of why in the world would the brain be programmed in such a way for these two behaviors to emerge like this. This draw to incentives, be it money or peers, this vigilance towards cues in the environment that might be threatening, and then this complete fearlessness in new environments, even when threat had occurred in that location, and then the subsequent delay in memory. And so a way that we've been thinking about this is, why would an adolescent ever leave our homes where we provide food and many of us do their laundry and they are very safe? Why would they ever even think that they would need to go out and explore the world and uncover new resources so they don't deplete those at home and actually find a new mate that they go on and procreate with? However, if they're pulled out into that environment and a predator comes along, they're no longer, they're no better than if they just stayed at home and done nothing. So it's important for them to be vigilant about cues in the environment and recognize those that are safe or threatening. And then the importance of, if you have one bad experience the first time you go out, this notion of then you're not going to explore these environments again. And so that's consistent with perhaps this fearlessness during adolescence. But why would we be so that we would remember it later? Well, it actually turns out it's around P49 where you start to see the memories emerge. It's right around the time when the mouse becomes capable of procreating. So you want to have a memory when you set up your home in an area that's going to be safe, because you don't want to set up a home in an environment that's going to be threatening. So basically, we think that this delayed memory is adaptive at a later stage. But I think what it's highlighting is adolescence is also potentially this other risk period. We always think about 0 to 3 and changes that are occurring there. But if you have a trauma during the adolescent period, you might not express emotions there, but it doesn't mean that we might not want to talk that out with the adolescent, because we may see it later when they experience another trauma. So I'd like to end just by trying to remind us that a lot of us think that adolescence is just these thrills, they're never thinking. Adolescence is a time of real thrills and real fears. And it's the combination of the two that have allowed the species to survive and also ultimately the fittest of the species. But in our society today, when adolescence is prolonged, it's a time when actually, some of these skills may not be so adaptive, and I think that's reflected in the health statistics with the increased mortality rate. So I'd like to stop there and just leave this slide acknowledging so many who have contributed to this work. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, BJ, for that riveting talk. I'd now like to invite Bruce and Mary Jean to join BJ and myself at the table to continue the discussion. I thought maybe to start, it would be nice if Mary Jean and Bruce could tell us a little bit about the focus of their own work. Mary Jean, as I mentioned, focuses on substance abuse and Bruce on stress, and obviously those are directly related to some of the topics that BJ has raised. But Mary Jean, would you like to start?
Well, we focus on studying the molecular neurobiology and also the human molecular genetics of three major addictive diseases. Alcoholism, which is the most common of the three we study. 19 million in the US are afflicted with this disorder, and it starts young. We'll come back to that. The second is opiate addiction. Opiate addiction now is the number one killer of our adolescents and our young adults. 50 people a day die of heroin or oxycodone overdose. And that is very new. This has ascended over the last decade, much increase in the deaths due to illicit opiate use. But we also have addiction, and I'm happy to say we have superb pharmacotherapies, the first of which a team that I was a part of developed here at Rockefeller and used worldwide, so there's no excuse for a long-term opiate addict not receiving treatment. This is a footnote to so many news articles we've had since the Hoffman death. And finally, cocaine dependency, which I'll probably come back to, because some very exciting work there has taught us enormous amounts about manipulating stress responsivity and its sequela. We also have one wonderful young investigator in our lab who is studying oxycodone, in adolescent mice, 11-day mice, which are very tiny, versus adult mice, which also aren't so large. And this young woman has the skills to do intravenous self-administration studies in the little mice and the slightly bigger mice. And she has found profound differences in gene expression changes when oxycodone is self-administered by for 2 weeks by the little ones versus the adults. And further, she has found that little ones who self-exposed have a profoundly different, possibly much more reward when they re-expose in adult life. So this is kind of the spectrum. Our human molecular genetics, I have to say, is thrilling. And just last week, we published yet another paper, this time defining 10 stress-responsive genes in humans that are strongly associated with opiate dependency.
At the beginning of my career at Rockefeller, well, actually, I'll even start before. I was a student here of the late Alfred Mirsky and Vincent Allfrey, who were, among other things, the discoverers of what is now known as epigenetics, the environmental modulation of gene expression. When, at the beginning of my career here, we discovered somewhat serendipitously that a part of the brain that's involved in memory and now mood, known as the hippocampus, after the seahorse because of its shape, had receptors for stress hormones, for cortisol. And at first, and for a long time, and it is still somewhat true, everybody thought that, well, stress damages the brain, the idea that you lose neurons and so on. And there's some truth in this, especially under very traumatic conditions such as seizures and head trauma and so on. But we've gone on to study the fact that the hippocampus and, in fact, other parts of the brain are plastic structurally in the sense that there is neurogenesis in the hippocampus. New neurons are produced through adult life. There is the remodeling of dendrites, the arms of neurons that receive input. There is turnover of synapses, the actual contacts between cells. This is going on all the time throughout the entire life course, and it's influenced very strongly by early life events. This is now referred to in some ways as biological embedding. So early life adversity, good or bad experiences, actually get under the skin and alter the way the brain is developed, just the way BJ was talking about the prefrontal cortex. It turns out from some work related to her laboratory that one of her students shows that early life stress actually causes a premature closure of some of the windows of this development. So there's a lot to be learned about the lasting influence of early life adversity or positive experiences on how the brain develops and the brain functions. And one final point is that because the brain controls body functions through the neuroendocrine system, my laboratory is Laboratory of Neuroendocrinology, because it regulates the autonomic nervous system and directly and indirectly the immune system and the metabolic system, that all of these systems depend very much on the health of the brain, and they feed back through their hormones to affect how the brain works.
Thank you. Maybe I can ask a few questions before I open it up to develop some of the themes that you've touched on. And BJ, just hearing you at the end, thinking through the why do adolescents exhibit these behaviors? And of course, the usual touchstone in thinking about these why questions is the evolutionary context. So you provided an evolutionary explanation for the benefits of this in enabling adolescents to prepare for separation and to leave the nest. If that's the case, and with that rationale, we can see the potential benefits, to what extent should we be trying to calm those behaviors? To what extent should we be trying to intervene to reduce the risk? Are we going to interfere with the separation? What's the right balance to strike?
That's true. Clearly, I used to think that if I locked my son up until he was 21, then everything would be fine. but that's not the case. The brain is not magically maturing. It is being hardwired through experiences. And so the adolescent does need opportunities in which they can regulate their behavior and regulate their emotions with oversight and checking in. But I think it's very important that we recognize when there's an emotional outburst from an adolescent, most parents are working right at threshold. They're really stressed. And so when you hear a word that you use maybe more than your child has used up until that point, you want to have an explosion. But it's better if you can take a deep breath as well as help your child take a deep breath and let them bring it down. I know when my 11-year-old went through the beginnings of adolescent, came back and used a word. Poor guy, he comes back naturally, I'm Irish. But he used a word that I haven't even used. And I couldn't even say anything. And of course, what does an adolescent say then? They say, "All right, already, don't talk to me." But I was just flabbergasted. He goes up to his room. But what else is going on in an 11 or 12-year-old? They want to eat all the time. I'm cooking dinner. He smells the food. He comes down. He won't even have eye contact with me. He's just next to me. And I just think, had a rough day. And he still doesn't say anything, but he eats dinner and everything's fine. But these opportunities of not exacerbating, but helping them be able to learn how to regulate is going to be important. It's not going to be the case when you have someone who just can't bring it down. And I think it's good to have conversations with your children, but at times when they're calm, and to talk with them as opposed to at times when they're at the heat of the moment, because, I'll stop there.
Well, maybe I can reframe the same question, but for Bruce in the context of stress. Again, we our instinct often is to shelter our children, but when should we allow them to experience stress? Is there such a thing as beneficial stress, especially during this adolescence period?
Well, stress, of course, is a very often used and somewhat ambiguous term, and I think what we mean by, some people mean by stress is positive stress, like sitting up here before an audience and hopefully things will go well. And if they do, you feel lifted by the experience. And then there's tolerable stress, where something bad happens, major life events, I mean something, you lose a job, things that are pretty doggone important. But the person has good internal resources, they have good self-regulatory skills, good brain architectures, we talk about it, and they can weather the storm, not only because of their own internal resources, but also because of external support, both material and social support by friends and family, and therapists if necessary. And then there's something that we can call toxic stress, and that almost speaks for itself. And this is very characteristic of people who have had the early life adverse experiences, abuse, neglect, and so forth, who whose systems are brains are not developed in an adaptable way. Their prefrontal cortex may not be able to control the amygdala and the nucleus accumbens, for example, and they will engage in substance abuse, antisocial behavior, depression. And because of their body systems are influenced by the brain, they also will have obesity, perhaps diabetes, cardiovascular disease. So this is what we mean by the biological embedding in the negative sense of the word. So the basic question is, yes, if a person develops good self-regulatory behavior and has good support systems, then they will do well. But of course, the other part of the realization that the brain has plasticity is that perhaps we can intervene even after these adverse experiences have taken place and actually make things better. And so there's now a move in this new view of epigenetics that we can intervene, maybe chemically, maybe something as simple as regular physical activity actually turns on plasticity mechanisms, and we can direct it the way we want to go with a therapeutic intervention.
Perhaps we could discuss substance abuse. And BJ, you showed that graph of, showing that 18-year-olds, 20% of 18-year-olds are using or have recently used drugs of abuse. Is that all part of this package that goes along with adolescence of behaviors that are involved in leaving the nest, or is it something else? Somehow it doesn't seem like we should necessarily be programmed to experiment with drugs of abuse as part of this program. And I'd also like to ask both you and Mary Jean, what do we know about why some people who use drugs or alcohol become dependent while others can take them or leave them? So, but first on the where does it come from? Is it part of this evolutionary program?
So drugs are more accessible, and we began the discussion with talking about the increased experimentation. So it's not surprising to me, and in fact, Mary Jean, I don't know about you, but those statistics look low relative to when we get anonymous ratings sometimes of what high school and college students are
the rigorous
using.
Surveys, yeah, very
right.
low.
I think, talk about this.
I remember on council of NIDA years ago, a very wonderful epidemiologic study that you hear about every January, Monitoring the Future. Comes out on radio with all their hot new findings, and the numbers are actually much higher than even that showed. But they were starting their study at age 16, and being a very outspoken council member, I said, I think that's a little bit old. I think you ought to put it down. We have hardcore heroin addicts in New York City who've used heroin daily, multiple uses a day for 3 years or more by age 15. So I think you better put your study down to 12, and they did that. And they have revealed enormously scary but important things. Most youngsters experiment in the home. So if there's a tiny bit of alcohol, a half glass of wine or something stronger, in the old days when there were butts of cigarettes, they would try the cigarettes, they still sip the wine. I really can't speak to the issue, but I hear that in some households they will find marijuana being used by their parents. We're too old for that, I guess, but in any event, whatever.
Or you don't live in Colorado.
We don't live in Colorado or the state of Washington. And I'm deeply concerned, if you want to ask me that question, Mark, because we are finding the profound brain changes with regular heavy use, incidental small use of many drugs, fortunately, don't change a brain forever. And again, I have said in one interview that if we could know precisely when the brain starts changing, then we would know when danger or pre-addiction is upon us. We do know in our rat and mouse models that one dose, you get gene expression changes, you get a lot of behavioral changes, it goes away. Three uses, it begins to be more subtle, and the changes are in fact different than at one day. But by 14 days, and you hear my lab repetitively going for 14 days, maybe 10 would do it, 7 actually doesn't. We begin to see profound changes in the brain, which then persist for weeks or months after we stop the drug administration in the animal. So the brain is remolded in its connectivity, in its gene expression, in what we call its proteomics, meaning its peptides that are around receptors and hormones. And it has changed in terms of wiring, which changes behaviors. Now, we know that when youngsters experiment, and the biggest experimentation is late high school and college, where peer pressure plays an enormous role. When each of us went to college, each in different, slightly different epochs in different colleges, we knew alcohol use was much higher in volume and numbers of days than it was when we were in high school or following college. And there have been studies proving that most people really decrease or eliminate alcohol abuse, heavy use, once they graduate. But that's changed, and I want to warn you as parents, the new data from the NIAAA, Alcoholism Institute, teach us that now youngsters are drinking not up to five drinks, which is the top epidemiology question asked with monitoring the future and other such. It is 10, 15, and 20. I ask you to debrief your freshmen in college and beyond, as I do people that come to my lab for the summer or after graduation. And further, the weekend, when I went to college, it was Saturday. When you went to college, it probably was Friday and Saturday. It is now Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and I was corrected yesterday. In some colleges, it's now Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, because nobody, no senior, ever takes a course on Friday. Neither do most juniors, unless you're pre-med or pre-science. And so therefore, you're out of there and into the party scene or the frat scene or just hiding in your room, which is similarly dangerous. But peer pressure plays a huge role. And of course, the number one drug of abuse in that setting remains alcohol, although cocaine is there, Oxycontin is there, heroin is creeping in, and marijuana is certainly there. So we have first experimentation, just curiosity, wine glass. Then we have a little bit more exploration. I felt different. How did you feel? Did you feel better or worse? Most people who use opiates for the first time, excuse my language, have an episode of nausea and vomiting. You ask them, why did you continue? Why did you take the second or tenth dose of heroin or Oxycontin if this happened? Well, because after that, I felt warm and I felt detached. And the way I felt was away from all stress, and I also felt normal. So opiate addicts as a group love to avoid stress. I do my charade. Conversely, cocaine, amphetamine, methamphetamine, and even alcohol users like to be activated. They like to be with it, disinhibited, out there chatting, doing whatever, sharpest attack. And if you look at the attack rate, you'll see that reflected until the data became so scary. Two blocks from here, close to a high school and a children's park, everything in the world is sold. This always horrifies everyone, but it's true. And where everything is sold, cocaine costs $2.50 for crack cocaine, $2.50 for a bag of heroin. It's actually $40 for a Vicodin pill or oxycodone pill, so that's why kids are turning to heroin early on and dying of it. To get into a movie is now $10 to $12. To buy a candy bar of reasonable size, it's $5. So behavioral economics, a word I don't find fondly, but nevertheless does play a role. I agree with Bruce about people who've had early imprinting, and we now find one young investigator in my lab threw a rat into a cold swimming pool. It was a bowl of water. They hate it. They get very immobile. We now know the system that causes stress, depression, dysphoria, in part, is what I call the dark side opiate. Endorphin, great. The other endorphin, not great. Beta endorphin makes you feel good, high, it's part of the reward system. Dynorphin binds to the kappa receptor, and it says, I don't like this. But it also is saying to your dopamine system, not so much reward. Let us tone this down. So it was a good system by nature, but if that system is overly activated, which it is in stressful situations, we know in mice, rat, and now humans, then you get a problem. Well, all of these things teach us that you can change your brain and then you get into a problem of constant drug use. But it's not just people that have had bad upbringing or early epigenetic changes. And I always like to say this with a wonderful group like we have here tonight. It's not them, it's us that see problems with drug abuse and drug addiction. And the sooner we realize that addictions are diseases, not just evil behavior, which they can be associated with, but they're not, the sooner we'll be able to come on to the real prevention, early intervention, and treatment efforts that we certainly need right now.
Thank you. I think we'll open it up to questions from the audience.
So thank you so much. This has been fascinating. You talked about the adolescence extending now past maybe traditional timeframes. And something else that we're seeing seems to be that it's actually starting earlier, whether the early onset is because of diet or toxicity in the environment or, you know, whatever. There are hormonal changes happening sooner and sooner. And so are you seeing, with this extended adolescence, are you seeing the prefrontal cortex catching up at all, or is there just this longer and longer period of time where the adolescent is exposed to a more possibly dangerous lack of cohesion between the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex?
Well, of course, it's also the case if you're seeing earlier puberty, the demands on the adolescent are numerous, right? They're going through physical changes. People are treating them differently. And when they're treating them differently, then they have these demands on them intellectually and their behavior. So that's a problem. But there is a biological readiness for the system. So with these changes, it's a little bit harder for a 9-year-old to cope with those changes and how they're being dealt with by others than a 13 or 14-year-old. There have been a number of concerns about this, but then also just the culture and society. There have been studies, Larry Steinberg's work, who's an adolescent psychologist, he's been looking at a multitude of cultures, and he's actually been seeing these risk-taking behaviors regardless of the culture. But it still seems that the adult roles are protracted in most societies, and so they're not forced to begin to they're so busy they can't get in trouble, in fact, in terms of taking supporting roles. And so that's something to keep in mind, because those experiences are helping to shape the brain as it's continuing to be plastic during this stage.
I mean, just thinking about how early a child has perhaps a cell phone or a computer in their hand, and we don't fully understand what implications that are for brain development. And then, of course, the later on texting and obsession with needing to be in touch with friends. So there's a whole problem out there that we have to explore.
Do we know that it's a problem?
Well, it's a good question. I mean, there are advantages to it for interactions. But on the other hand, I think one of the biggest problems with teenagers is sleep loss, because unless one removes their texting devices so they can get a decent night's sleep. And I, you know, talking to teachers and parents at a number of, you know, high schools, you know that there's an issue with that, as along with the other demands on a child in terms of achievement and sports, athletics, social activities. So I think there's a good side, obviously, as there can be, and a bad side.
They're driven by incentives. So make their time texting and on the computer part of them having accomplished something or achieved something, and let them feel that success of working toward that, as opposed to just letting them have the text and the phone. But I can tell you, with my adolescent, who's now 19, he would never pick up the phone when his mother calls, but he will respond to a text because he'll look at it just to see if it's someone else. And what you want your adolescent to do is, if they're about to engage in something risky, which there's a situation, if you can just get them to take a deep breath, and even just checking for the text might be enough to deter them, so.
Yeah, I agree with that. When they look at the text, they say, that's mother. It's kind of like that ad on radio which says, don't turn right now, go slower. The GPS system is now your mother, and I think that's close to what we're getting to be.
Actually, I have twins, and I have two 17-year-olds, and I feel, it's funny, they're very different, boy-girl. My main concern is that at least the private schools put so much pressure on these kids, and they feel like they have to get straight A's and they have to get high SAT scores and or ACT scores. And then what I'm seeing is that they're going out, just like what you said, Friday night and Saturday night. We all know that they do things, you know, the parents don't know what to do. And we're all very concerned. But when you talk about stress, how do you regulate, or how do you, you know, you want them to have downtime, and you can't, you know, tell them to stay in the house. So how do you deal with that?
I think that Bruce will probably comment on this too, mm-hmm. but you don't want them just to stay at home. And I can't say enough about physical activity and time to relax and how we have played that down in terms of just achieve, 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 achieve. There are so many changes that we're beginning to recognize that exercise can do and provide for the brain, and also changes in neurochemicals that are very important, and changes that you might see similar changes with SSRIs or things that would decrease the anxiety. But Bruce, did you want to comment on this?
These, at least with the boys, they have soccer, they come home at 7 o'clock at night, then on top of the physical activity, they have to do their homework, and then they're up till 3 in the morning. And there are some kids who take drugs, and not only do they take cocaine, I heard that some of them are taking shrooms. I never even heard of shrooms, mushrooms, or whatever. And it's really, I think it's so sad that they feel that this is the only way to have a release. And I think there's a lot with the peer groups, they go to houses, they, you know, who knows what goes on.
What you've just said, we see a lot of the self-administration behaviors to actually avoid something. And what you've just mentioned, of course, is a new class of hallucinogens, which I did not discuss. But I think, don't worry too much about your son. My two adult children both went to independent schools here in Manhattan, and I think it was a blessing that they had a very long school day, and they did survive doing their homework in the night. However, we didn't, for reasons that are probably that we were too busy ourselves, put pressure on them to do well. In fact, I thought my daughter was mentally challenged until I had to be called in the third grade and said, no, and she's now just joined the faculty of Harvard Medical School, so maybe she is, but it's a different way. But I think having athletics built in, I'm concerned up to the kazoo about public schools now, because they've eliminated art, they've eliminated music, and they've eliminated much of physical education. And I think as a public school graduate, I would like to see us really support having activity, art, music, alternatives to the stress of just memorizing academic stuff, whatever it is.
If I could just add one more thing. You mentioned boys and girls, and I think we often overlook the fact that there are very fundamental differences in brain development. Prefrontal cortex matures more quickly in women, females, than in males, and in the effects of hormones, sex hormones and sex difference throughout the entire brain. So we really shouldn't lump together boys and girls.
Could you just speak a little to the adolescent biochemistry? Like, you show such remarkable differences with the adolescent brain. What is going on biochemically in the brain that could be causing these differences?
Talk about some of the changes in dopamine.
I think the hormones are playing a big role, and Bruce is probably the best to speak about that. They begin to oscillate even before your child has obvious stigmata of onset of puberty. They start to oscillate when you're actually quite young. And we know that in Bruce's lab more than mine, but in both of our labs, we're studying estrogen versus androgen effects in our mice and rats, and it really reinforces. When we give cocaine to a female, she runs around, mouse or rat, she runs around a lot more than the male does. And as she's a female coming into childbearing age, she cannot make a nest. Isn't that interesting? So the behavior is being changed and changed differently in the two genders. We know biochemistry of the brain is also different. Our endorphin system is with us from birth, but the activation of the endorphins we think we like, beta endorphin, to give it a name, it acts at the mu opioid receptor system, changes with age to a certain extent. What we know that's even more important, though, is something I didn't mention, is 1 in 5 of us in this room have a gene variant that alters our response to stress, and it's a gene variant in that mu opioid receptor system, when beta endorphin binds to it, it binds much more tightly. If we have a variant, that's good news, that's bad news. It can be good news in transient stress, it can be bad news in chronic stress. And we've now proven that both in our humans, but now we have a rodent model of this particular variant. So it's very complicated. The biochemistry doesn't change radically. You have the same neurotransmitters, neuropeptides, once you get to about 2 months. But on the other hand, it is modified hugely by the hormonal system.
And just to add to that, I mean, I think we one of the most neglected areas in research is how, in the developing brain, is how the gonadal hormones and genetic sex differences affect brain development. We know more about the onset of puberty in terms of reproductive ability, but very little about how the rest of the brain is developing.
And we actually don't know as much as we ought to about older people. Bruce and I have discussed a great deal the estrogen tamoxifen difference. You can ask me later.
I have two questions, please. One, when I think Dr. Kreek said about the successive time of usage from 3 to 10 to 14, and how the children were getting more involved in alcohol younger. And I'm curious, you didn't mention too much about the repair time and what the repair is and how long it takes, and are these rehab centers that we have numerous of them across the United States, how effective are they in a 30-day time period? Because 1 in 5 stays sober when they come out after a year has passed.
After a year has passed, mm-hmm. 1 in 5, if they had cocaine or alcohol, if they have opiates, it's less than 1 in 5. We find that less than 10% of all opiate addicts are able to stay abstinent however long they're in prison or rehab, a prison without drugs, which is hard to find, or a rehab center that's superb and supportive and everything else. You know, and you said it in your question, 30-day rehab is frankly worthless. And we know that it's worthless. And we know that there's very good outpatient treatment, pharmacotherapy for opiate addiction. We have one good medication for alcoholism, but it reaches only about 35%. And it reaches primarily the people that have this gene variant that my lab discovered and have studied. So we know that genetic differences will also change response to treatment in that case. We know that cocaine addiction, of the 3 major addictions we study, we have the best, if you will, recovery rate with abstinence-based treatment. We've had to study it because, to date, my lab and all the rest have not been successful, although we finally, I think, Mark, are on the brink of having a kappa-directed compound to use to see if that will help with cocaine dependence. But we know that there are about 30% of long-term hardcore cocaine addicts that can become and stay abstinent. They have to have good talk therapy. They have to have peer support. Many of the best outcomes are actually from the storefront counseling and group interaction treatments, not the fancy ones. The fancy ones cost a lot of money, and you probably will get a good medical evaluation, hopefully, but they are not particularly effective, and I'm glad to say that very publicly.
Thank you. And then also, in regards to marijuana, particularly, of course, Colorado, do you feel that marijuana is a gateway drug to higher drugs?
There's data saying yes, and they're interesting data. There's data saying yes to tobacco, similarly being a gateway. There's also much data suggesting that most families that now have addiction in the family have a family history, but that family history is usually alcoholism because that's what was there many years ago. And we know that multiple gene variants have to be present to increase the vulnerability to develop an addiction once exposed. The marijuana story, I think we're going to see unfold. The great concern I have is in Colorado and in Washington State, they are already seeing huge incremental use by those under 21, the group to whom it is not being sold. Wow, is that a big surprise? How many youngsters under 21 get access to alcohol, including in our most prestigious colleges? I think we have to be very concerned between the, if you will, casual marijuana use, which apparently is extremely common, and I will tell you, in my healthy volunteers here at Rockefeller, I've had to accept up to 5 or 10% that may use marijuana 1 to 10 times a month. not a whole bag, but just a whatever, one joint, I think it's usually referred to in this environment, of marijuana. I'm not very well trained, obviously. My friends that study marijuana addiction uptown say it's truly bimodal, but they're terrified of what's going to be in between. And this is what we have seen precisely with alcohol. We have many people that drink one, two, or three drinks, fine, no problem. They have no family history, no genetic overload, and in fact, it may even be helpful, who knows? There's some studies that say yes. But then there's a group that drink too much. And this is a group that hopefully, with a new parity of asking questions and getting paid to ask those questions, if you're a physician or nurse practitioner, we will begin to prevent progression. Alcohol, I hope marijuana as well. I find it especially terrifying, though, one in three people that ever use heroin become addicted. We don't know the data for OxyContin yet. We're all paralyzed with fear. We'd like to see those youngsters stop, and I've actually put a segment of my lab working on an OxyContin vaccine now.
How difficult, or is it even possible, for the average person to be tested for the gene variant?
Oh, that's a good question, but I think we almost better have another meeting on that someday. But let me say that the gene variants for diseases that are single gene diseases that have been well defined and studied, it is not difficult at all. There are superb resources that exist. One can get counseling and go in and be tested. 23andMe, there's some companies online where people can get tested. Some people find this reassuring. They can find they did or didn't have something that's pretty common. I'll tell you where the problem comes. Most diseases are complex diseases. Many gene variants, and I mean many, not just two or three, but maybe 10, maybe 20, maybe 100, contribute to the increased vulnerability. So if you're dealing with a single gene disease, and there are a lot of them, cystic fibrosis, sickle cell anemia, then it's terrific to have this. I always advise people to go through the genetic counseling and testing with a proper place, but some people will do it online. But the A118G variant we discovered should be available commercially, and it's not. Why should it be? Because if you have that variant, and if you're an alcoholic, it predicts good outcome with a simple treatment with naltrexone. Now, wouldn't that be exciting to get 20% of our alcoholics treated easily and cheaply? Yeah, it would, and it would save the country a lot of money. So that's the only one of my gene variants that I think should be out there, and it's not yet.
Hi, thank you. So a friend of mine is from South America, and she has this saying in Spanish that she tells her daughter, and it sounds much better in Spanish, but I can't say it in Spanish. So the essence of it is, when her daughter's going out, be mischievous, but do it smartly. And so I wonder, it always sort of sparked me that was a clever, and I wonder if there's science behind this, perhaps, that maybe we say, okay, you're going to be mischievous, perhaps we can create, or if there's research that potentially creating forums for our adolescents to be mischievous and take risks in a smart way, maybe perhaps an Outward Bound type of program. Is there research that attitude, that basic approach, and perhaps creating risks in a more controlled environment might be a helpful way to deal with this desire for risk?
I think there have been a number of programs that they've started to try to allow the adolescent to be a risk taker, but in a controlled environment. In Harlem, there were actually indoor climbing, sort of like indoor rock climbing. And but I think you said something else that might also be helpful in terms of what you're telling an adolescent. If you're saying, okay, behave in this certain way, that's almost like you're accepting it. And this is a time when they're kind of distancing themselves from you. So you've already brought to their attention something that now it's not that novel for them to engage in. And I think that's very important. One of the times when I was on NPR and I was supposed to be the brain scientist, the questions weren't so much about the brain, and today it's been very much about that, biochemicals and the sort. But there was a caller, and none of the other male neuroscientists wanted to take the question, and they couldn't see us because it was a radio. But the question was, my 13-year-old wants to get a tattoo, and I have no idea what to do because I'm afraid she's going to go out and get a tattoo anyway.
So none of them would take it. But this had just happened to me. My son wanted to get a tattoo. And so I explained it. And then she said, so what did you do? And I said, I'm going to get a tattoo too, just like yours. So sometimes putting it in a context that it's not that bold or whatever, because you would do it and you're the parent. It's interesting. He didn't do it.
I think in the interest of time, we're going to take two more questions.
So many more children or adolescents now are on prescription drugs like Adderall. How does that weigh in here? Or does it?
Actually, Adderall is both a drug of very major therapeutic use and great abuse. It's number four in the abuse column. It's time will tell. I think the issue, and take methylphenidate, Ritalin, which has been very widely used for years for attention deficit disorder children and adults. And in fact, it fortunately, I think, now has an extended release which prevents a peak effect and a valley effect. And I think there are pretty good data at the bench and some data clinically showing that that has less abuse potential, but probably also better for treating the disorder that it's aimed at. There are studies ongoing, and there's still the answer still to be forthcoming with ADHD and the various treatments that have been offered for that. And I think in some countries like Sweden, the diagnosis is very rarely made. In US, the diagnosis is very frequently made. The idea of early therapeutics versus waiting for a while is still very controversial within the field of psychiatry. And in neurochemistry, I watched the data with great interest because, of course, there is a substantial comorbidity of ADHD and especially cocaine dependency and alcohol dependency, just as there's a very high comorbidity of depression and anxiety with each of the addictive diseases. But I don't think we know. What we do know is that a medication that does not have on-off properties that can be steady state, like methadone maintenance, as used in maintenance treatment for heroin addiction, like buprenorphine and naloxone, as used for that purpose, not only does not disrupt the brain chemistry, but it allows it to normalize with time. And I failed to answer part of a question of another person in the audience here. The brain healing does occur, but over a very different time frame for different insults, including, I'm sure, stress and stressors. And sometimes, if there are epigenetic changes, maybe we can reverse it by behavior or medication. Sometimes, if it's caused by an illness or by a drug of abuse, which causes a disease to become manifest genetically, vulnerabilities there, you have to have the drug to develop the disease. But the coming to a normal brain, we don't know. And I gave you the data about outcome, cocaine versus alcohol versus opiates. It is extremely slow, we know that. And I hope we can study medications that we know are beneficial, like Adderall, like methylphenidate, Ritalin, and become more knowledgeable about what they actually do.
Just a quick comment. There are no magic bullets for these kind of disorders. And getting back to the theme of plasticity, the best you can hope for with a drug or another intervention like physical activity is that it will open up something and then some targeted intervention will push it in the right direction. So you don't want to interfere with that, but you don't want to trust that the drug will take care of everything.
My question is about behavior. I have a 12-year-old and he hasn't come in contact with alcohol and another, that stuff that I'm sure is going to become a problem later on. But just the way he has become, he has gone from a very sweet 11-year-old to a kind of aggressive and, you know, wants to be the boss of the house. And I am a single parent, and I want to make sure that I retain that authority without and allowing him to be the man of the house that I think he wants to be, because I think it's part of the development. into a man, into a little, you know, a teenager. So my question is, how do I balance that very snappy, aggressive little bits and, you know, that we have, that interaction, without losing my identity as a parent and not have those arguments? I don't argue, so I want to try to embrace everything.
I'll make one comment, and that is one of the best things that we can do during adolescence, at a time when their brain and their behavior is probably most plastic relative to what's to come, is to catch them when they're doing the right thing. Because reinforcing good behavior goes a long, long way. Saying no and reprimanding isn't reinforcing the opposite behavior. So when you can do that, but rules are very important. And many times, I think as parents, we don't want to be the nag. And there's research that's coming out that they're hearing us. They're listening to us, even if it seems like they're not, even if they're texting the whole time. It's changing the way they're thinking and the way they're behaving. So keep talking, set your rules, and do. They love it when you catch them doing something good.
I think that's terrific advice.
Bruce, you want to?
No, this is great. I agree.
And now please join me in thanking our panelists for an excellent